Hello and welcome to BW Hot Fires. We have with us Mr. Pankaj Dubey, who was the former managing director of Polaris India. He is now with Power Global, a company which has been making lithium-ion batteries for automotive and other industries. Thank you so much for sparing your time for BW Business World. Sir.
Yeah, it's nice to be on Business World Hot Wire.
Thank you, sir. First of all, sir, as you know, you've been an auto industry veteran. You have been in diverse segments of the automotive industry. You were with Yamaha, you were with a tractor manufacturer, Escorts, if I'm not wrong. And then you moved on to Polaris, and now you're with Power Global. So how is the, like, how do you see the industry evolving? And do you still see auto industry as a critical contributor to the country's GDP?
Definitely, Abhishek, automobile industry is one of the prominent industry which contributes substantially to the GDP of the country. And the transportation as such is very critical for any economy to grow. And the vehicle industry definitely is a major contributor in that sense to the movement of products, goods, people. And the penetration of these vehicles in India is, by comparison, still very low. So if you see that per thousand, how many cars, how many bikes, then that penetration level is still much smaller than what you see in the equally developed economy, or even some of the developing economy also has per thousand people more vehicles than what we have in India. So therefore, the scope for the auto industry is really very good from a long-term perspective. In short terms, all the challenges keep coming and going off. So we have seen this happening multiple times, and we have seen that more in the last 3-4 years, where a lot of environmental changes has happened, leading to newer norms, newer vehicles, more upgradations. But auto industry has lived up to the expectations of the requirements at current times, and with the regulatory authorities trying to frame new rules. Every time auto industry has been able to meet all the deadlines. And therefore, I see that this industry is continuing to grow. The form may change here or there, like we have seen the mix changing from petrol to petrol and diesel. We've seen a big change happening from two-stroke to four-stroke. And then EFI engines, and slowly and gradually we are moving towards electric vehicle industry. A small pie has already been taken. We have seen more growth in the three-wheelers and electric vehicle. Now small, the commercial cars are happening. Two-wheelers are slightly growing up. So overall industry would definitely contribute. The mix of the industry, whether how much would be petrol, how much will be diesel, how much will be electric, it will keep on changing, or maybe there's some alternate energy also possible which may come in future, but I'm pretty sure that the vehicle industry is going to continue for a long time to contribute to the GDP.
So coming back to the auto industry, so I mean, what do you see this what are your projections for the future? I mean, are we moving towards zero emission mobility completely, or you think ICE engines are going to coexist with zero emissions, or you think hybrid is the next step? Where are we heading to? Can you give a medium term to long term outlook of the auto industry, especially in India?
So when we see the total industry, the hybrid vehicle as such has not taken off, and it's not much appreciated because it's not zero emission. So it's basically a solution, because we feel that the zero emission or the electric vehicle will not be able to sustain the requirements of the users. And therefore, we should have a hybrid that if he gets stuck anywhere, he can switch on to the IC engine and work. But that's something which is a solution which is short term. I don't see that it's going to go for very long, the hybrid vehicles. Okay. The moment the zero emission vehicles have a long range, the way that you have it for the current IC engine vehicles. Same way, the moment the electric vehicle also has that technology and the charging infrastructure and everything is built up, you will not feel the need for the hybrid vehicle. Coming back to the IC versus the zero emission vehicle, I see that increasingly, I don't see, unless and until there is a ban by the government, that IC will completely become zero, because or unless the you get stop supply of the fuel itself, until that time I don't see that the vehicle would not, the IC engines will not be preferred, because IC engines are like traditional vehicles, and we as such feel very happy and to use some of the technologies of the past. So the past vintage cars, the new cars, the modern technology cars. Similarly, ICE, I won't call it, that it will become vintage, but definitely the share of the zero emission vehicle is increasingly going to be more and more popular among the masses, and it will become mass users at a time when the entire ecosystem is developed, where you have the infrastructure developed. Companies like Power Global has a big role to play in that, where we have this technology where people can use the zero emission vehicle in the same manner in which they use the current ICE vehicles. So in a short term and a medium term, short term I would say because of these challenges in the current times, there is an issue of the disposable income of the people. The need has increased, the requirement of the people to buy vehicles have really increased, they want to buy, and that's why you would see that there is an increasing trend of buying second-hand vehicles also. So it's improved a lot, and because of the social distancing, people prefer to have their own personal vehicle today. So the increase of requirement of the vehicles are there. On a medium term and a long term, I see that the mix would undergo a change, because of the support by the government, new players, new technologies, new companies coming in into this forum, like Power Global coming in. So similarly, there are other players also jumping into this bandwagon. You would know that there are so many companies who plan to start their own two-wheelers, three-wheelers, and possibly four-wheelers with the zero-emission vehicles. So those players will come, so they will help increase the market size. But with the support, and government really is pushing hard, India is one of the most progressive government internationally, which is pushing hard for the growth of electric vehicles. So there are very few equal examples where you can say that the government is pushing so much as opposed to when you see the comparison with various countries. So this shows that the government is very keen. Also, you can see that the industry is also very eager now, and they have invested. A lot of companies have come up and already set up the factories for two-wheelers and four-wheelers and three-wheelers. And with the challenge of the range being meted out with the new technologies that are coming in, that the vehicle can be driven more, like normally you would get 80 kilometers, 60 kilometers. Now people are talking about 120, 150, and with the good technologies, you can go up to 500, 600 kilometers also in a single charge. So, and with more intelligent management, instead of just going to the highest of the technology, which is like to the masses becomes unaffordable as well. So the moment these new breakthrough happens, where the battery charging is available the way that the petrol or diesel is available, same way if something happens, then the zero emission vehicles will take off a lot. So I see that government has done target date of 2030, where they want to see a major change in the electric vehicle industry. I see that that's going to happen. Because another 10 years down the line, I think today you and I are not on the electric vehicle, but I definitely see that in 10 years time we will be on an electric vehicle. So this paradigm shift is going to happen in the industry, and it may be the zero emission vehicles can be an electric, can also be some alternate where a lot of work is going on.
Just so viewers, if you can run us through what the company is basically into, and also how is it different from other players in the industry, and what difference is it going to make in the EV industry?
Yeah, so number one is that our company is been incorporated with the objective of public benefit. So, and we say that we would be for the benefit of the people at large. We are very concerned about the environment. So therefore, we will be focusing on projects and technologies which will preserve the environment. And definitely, the zero emission vehicles will take off and will reduce the pollution in the environment, and it will clean up the environment as such. So Power Global plans to get into two business currently, or that we have planned. One is the lithium ion batteries manufacturing in India, and number two is that we are going to focus on creating retrofit kit which will be used for converting the existing IC vehicles, focusing initially on three-wheelers, to get all the existing petrol and diesel three-wheelers get converted to a electric vehicle through our kit. So
retrofit kit, aftermarket kit.
So that kit we have developed, and so these are the two major areas that we'll be focusing in India. And on the first one, the lithium ion batteries, we would be supplying to mostly the OEMs, and also supply wherever we sell that retrofit kit. So it will be powered by Power Global. So the battery management system on the vehicle which the customers will do the retrofit would be our model. And in that, these facilitation will be such that the people will be using the vehicle very comfortably. And so we have to, we would create a mechanism where it becomes easy for the customers and the users of Power Global electric retrofit kit easily to get the charging facility in the vicinity, and to get, we're planning to make some kiosk and some battery swapping technologies and all, where customers would be able to get a better out of the existing vehicles. And this has been made in a way that, you know, it's a cost saving for the people who are currently running. So whatever the cost at which the current customers are running the vehicle, their cost will come down dramatically, at least 50% or so. We're expecting that the cost will go down for the running cost of the vehicle. And in other cases, you know, we will be supplying these batteries to the OEMs, or we can also explore supplying the kits to some of the OEMs where they can use our kit as a new vehicle also.
Okay. So, again, coming back to your company, Power Global. So, I mean, are they going to make these batteries in India? Will you be leveraging on the Atmanirbhar policy of the government? If yes, if you can talk about the investment, the facility, the number of people you will be employing, and also, I mean, your long-term plan, your CAPEX plan.
So, definitely, it will be, it is an Atmanirbhar plan only, sort of what Prime Minister has been saying. So, it will be similar to what he is saying, because the Power Global plans to manufacture, not assemble, but manufacture lithium ion batteries in the country. And we plan to source major, almost 100%, target is that we get almost 100% of the, even the raw material locally procured from India. So the sourcing also we are developing right now. So we're working, we have a team which is working right now also to ensure that whatever plans that we have, we source all the components from the country itself. And it requires a lot of work, and if there are any gaps, we are also ready to look at that we get either we invest ourselves or we get somebody to invest into that technology in India so that this dream becomes a reality. The dream of the conversion of electrofit kit and the electric vehicle grows in the country.
Okay, so if you can talk about the amount that you earmarked and where are you building your facility and how many people will be employed, and also the product, will it be only for the domestic market or global market? Will it be exported also?
Not? Yeah, so as far as the infrastructure, the where we are going to do, so right now we are talking to various governments, so we haven't finalized the location. So we are contemplating, we have already spoken to few, and then we are also getting in touch with few more states to see that where we should have it. And currently a lot of surveys are also being done by us to understand the where exactly would it make the best sense for the company to start the manufacturing. And from the point of view of investing, we plan to invest initially about 50 engineers, which will be totally focusing on the development of our new model. So that's the first investment that we are doing. And in a long term, this is going to be quite a big project. And it all definitely depends upon the kind of response that we get. But we are very hopeful that this will become a pretty big setup. And we plan to look at in 3 to 4 years time, by say 23-24, we plan to bring our own IPO to scale up the operations in India.
Okay.
At the same time, we are also looking at that this the products are largely from the Indian market point of view, but we have explored the export opportunities for these vehicles, the retrofit kit as well as the lithium ion batteries, to some of the neighboring countries, the Asian market, and also the Africa market. So we have a plan laid out that in next few years, 3 to 5 years time, we would be able to exploit the major areas of the global market from India.
I mean, coming back to the product, like, is it being designed, developed in the US, or is it being designed and developed over here? Because India is a very peculiar market. Here we have a tropical climate. I mean, certain batteries cannot withstand extreme temperatures, and also, I mean, there are dust, there are winds, there are all kinds of. India is in fact a continent for many companies. So, I mean, if you can run us through the research and development part of the product.
So basically, you know, when we talk about the research and development part, almost all the work has happened in US.
Okay.
And in terms of the extremities that we have in the temperature here in India, you know, some of the global companies, they create that. They create a chamber where they create the kind of a temperature and other parameters that you face in the country in any environment. So in US, when we test these vehicles and these retrofit kit, which is deployed on a vehicle, it is tested on the high temperatures and the low temperatures in India. Low to fair, US is much lower than us. So if you test it there, then your lower temperature is taken care of. But to create that high temperature, there's an artificial chamber which are created to create that environment, and so the products are being tested there in the similar environment.
Okay, so this your product lines have already been supplied to key OEMs in the US. Now you are trying to replicate that success in India. Is that what I can interpret from your words, or is it like India is a testing ground for you?
No, so this is a company which is a startup even in US. So okay. It has a start. So we are not supplying right now to any OEMs there, but Motor has the experience of working with many OEMs, and he has worked for the OEMs as well as been the vendor to many OEMs. And this is a new venture that he has started. Okay. And in this new venture, he is going to have the development, design, everything done there, but based on our discussions, what we discussed together, we felt that the best market for those products is India. because we are going to focus largely on a two-wheeler and three-wheeler space. And India is definitely one of the biggest market for two-wheelers and three-wheelers. And therefore, we feel that everything should be done here. And from here, we should do the supplies to all over the world. And since the products are latest, the technology is latest, the team members are very knowledgeable, and we know the Indian market. And so together, we are going to create this. The manufacturing, the full manufacturing would be in India only. Initially, they will do the prototypes and everything in US, and then the full-fledged manufacturing would start in India, and from here, we will supply everywhere.
Okay, but to customize the product for Indian conditions, for the local conditions, won't you be having a satellite R&D center over here?
That's what we said. You know, we are going to hire, the first set of people that we are going to hire is about engineers who would be involved into the engineering services, which is largely research and development, not only for the various adaptations for the Indian market, but also for any requirements that come globally for exports. So this team is going to, so the first set of team members that we have we are right now framed the kind of team members that we'll be requiring, and what sort of a skill sets we'll be needing with them, and then what development work needs to be done in India. So those are the things that we are looking at setting up the R&D facility in India.
Okay. And sir, you said you'll be catering to two-wheeler manufacturers and three-wheeler manufacturers and all. So are you saying that you're not interested in four-wheelers? Because four-wheelers is where the maximum action is, where Mahindra is also into it big time. Tata Motors is also getting into it big time. So, I mean, you don't find any opportunities in four-wheelers. Am I right in if I interpret your words?
So, yes, you are right. We plan to focus first on a two-wheeler and three-wheeler, and that is what our intention is. Now, once we start doing the lithium-ion battery manufacturing and we start sending it, we will study, we'll keep on studying, and we already have some discussions internally that, okay, what we should do, when we should get into the other segments. So we'll look at all those in future. But for now, the basis of the company to focus in the next few years would be on two-wheelers and three-wheelers only.
Can you provide a percentage mix of all your customer base? Like, what would be the percentage of auto customers? What would be for telecom? What would be for other industries?
If you can, I think initially we'll focus on the vehicle automotive industry, and then telecom comes as a very natural second industry. And but still, automotive I think would be the leader in terms of the pack that we will have the services to. So automotive will definitely have a major pie on our customer base. So automotive and telecom is the two major areas that we are looking at. Moving forward, it can be into some stationary applications also, where the stationary engines are being used right now for applications of because this is an energy pack, so it can do a lot of work that the existing diesel vehicles, diesel engines are being used. So, like in the fields, in number of farming applications, it can be used for powering the house. So, number of applications can be used in this.
Okay, fine.
But
okay,
it will be majority automotive and telecom.
Are you going to, be a part of that FAME II ecosystem? And what kind of contributions do we see from your end in contributing to the government mission of zero emission mobility? Although we know about your company, what you are going to do, but when it comes to FAME policy, I mean, what kind of opportunities do you see, and how are you going to leverage on that? How are you going to how are you going to fit into that ecosystem?
So, in terms of the FAME II policies, there have definitely been a lot of improvements, but at the same time, the industry expectations are much higher, and the kind of support that industry requires is much higher right now. And therefore, this dialogue between the government and the industry is going on, and there's a more need to give support to the industry, and industry also has to bring in some new technology and methods of working and all that. So it's an ongoing process, and the interest is there from both ends, but I think there has to be certain policy changes. What I feel is one big area where the government must look at is that, you know, the electric vehicle industry, despite the push in the last 2-3 years that the government has done, the industry has not grown much. You don't see much, electric vehicle on the road, especially from the consumer perspective. So not many consumers have said that, okay, I'm going to buy. And having analyzed that, you know, we need to build the infrastructure. And we all know that. Government also knows completely that what needs to be done. So like you have to have a battery swapping stations, you have to have battery charging stations, all of that government knows. But then, you know, it's not happening. One major policy change that can be done is to implement the retrofit kit. You know, we are thinking of selling, which is like there's a call of push marketing and there's a call of pull marketing. So when you do a push marketing, there are not many takers because we are saying, please buy because I have got this. So some people may get attracted, but the most of people don't buy with the push marketing. Pull marketing is that you give something that they want. And the moment you do that, you know, the market increases tremendously. So I feel that in this space, the pull marketing can be development of a policy of retrofit kit. So there are many players who have attempted this and they faced a lot of challenge. I spoke to many of the retrofit kit players who started and they felt a lot of challenge in implementing the government, adhering to the government policies with the retrofit kit. So what is very important is that when we are saying that we should increase the existing electric vehicle industry, one way is to sell new vehicles. The second is that we can convert the universe, which is huge, to electric through an e-retrofit policy. So I think it's very important that at the national level, an e-retrofit kit policy should be implemented where, you know, there will be an opportunity for an existing ICE engine owners to convert to electric. And that is where, you know, the population will happen. You know, why infrastructure is not getting built up? Why we are not having the charging station? Because if any person invest into the charging stations, there are not enough vehicles, electric vehicle industry to make that person viable. So if somebody invest into a charging infrastructure, he lose huge money because there's no vehicle to charge. And therefore his cost of investment, the investment that he does, doesn't get the return at all. So there are people who are sitting on the edge, they want to start. I know them personally. They really want to develop the infrastructure, but they are seeing that how will the vehicle, there's no vehicle. If I start, I mean, how will I get my return on investment? So despite all the goodwill and the appeals, this is a challenge. And I think there can be many policy changes, but one thing that I would suggest is to bring out an exhaustive e-retrofit kit policy where existing petrol and diesel vehicles get converted to electric. The biggest advantage of this is the moment the existing vehicle gets converted, there are masses available for the charging stations. Immediately charging stations would come up because all the companies who are ready to invest, they would see, oh, now the market is coming. And therefore they will invest, so infrastructure will get developed. With the infrastructure development, new vehicle sales will also start happening. So it's a cash 22 position. You know, we are saying that let the vehicle sale increase, then we'll put the infrastructure. Infrastructure, unless and until vehicle is there, it's not going to happen. Infrastructure without the vehicle sale is like a loss-making scenario, and therefore even if somebody invests, he will scale down the operation or he will shut down after some time. So it will become very detrimental to everyone. And in this case, if we make a electric vehicle retrofit kit policy, where you know the government will make it easier for this to implement. You know, one of the biggest bottleneck in the space of retrofit kit is that all the vehicles are identified with two things. One is the chassis number, and the second is the engine number. And that is what defines that vehicle. Now, the moment you convert a vehicle to a electric vehicle, now the engine has to be removed. What do we do with that engine, number one? Number two, if the vehicle is going on the road, the traffic authorities will say, where is the engine? Because there is no engine, so there is no engine number also in the vehicle. So how would they identify? So therefore, these are some of the big challenge which has been faced by the...
I mean, what is the ideal solution? How do you think, a retrofitment can get a major boost? You need some subsidies from the government? Or you need some cut in GST, or what kind of thrust is required from the government's end, and what is the time frame for that thrust? You want it for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 10 years, whatever it is, whatever you are looking for.
See, Abhishek, you know, subsidies are always welcome in the initial phase of any companies. So I would say that any support by the government for the first 5 years should be sufficient for any company to sustain. So if the business model is good, the company should be able to sustain, survive, and then create a business profitability on its own rather than depending upon the government support all the time. But since we are talking about creation of a new industry, initial support by the government is always helpful. And that's where I would look at that the policies by the government in terms of subsidy for manufacturing lithium-ion batteries, policy for retrofit kit, because that the moment you allow retrofit kit, the volume will scale up for the battery manufacturers, volume will scale up for the infrastructure developers, the battery charging station developers, and therefore the entire ecosystem will get a boost. So a combination of a subsidy for who's investing into the country. And I don't like subsidy as such, but because we are talking about a creation of the industry, that is where, you know, nobody's willing to invest and then lose huge amounts of money. And the government is not losing money. Government is going to gain money if this industry actually increases because of the balance of trade, which is going to improve with a lower import of the fuel. And government gains, when the industry develops, then government will definitely gain the taxes and revenues through the scale up of the industry. So initial support of say around 5 years, and these 5 years are the formative years where the industry will build up. So I would say that, you know, in terms of subsidy, if they give it to the charging stations, to the manufacturers of EV, to the manufacturers of batteries, it is going to help the industry to develop. As such, if you see that even if there is a lower GST, lower all taxes, make it easier for the company to come in, because you know, you set up a company, you have a huge infrastructure that you have to start with, you have to get the people in. You have to start paying salaries, and every investment has to be done. But then if the size of the industry is very small, because it's an evolving industry, it will take time for the return of investment for anybody who does the investments right now. So the moment the government plays a role where they said, okay, it's a new industry, I don't gain anything out of it today, it's fine. Let the industry develop right now. Let everybody become like a... Their payback time is shortened because of my support, the government support in terms of the taxes. That is where I would look at the government should do, and they should look at giving it for the first 5 years and then slowly phasing it out.
And sir, of late there are a lot of anti-China sentiments among people. So, I mean, people are shying away sourcing products from China. But when it comes to lithium-ion batteries, you have to rely on China. So, do you see that as the biggest stumbling block? Because, I mean, on one hand, you want to revolutionize the electric vehicle industry, but on the other hand, you have to source products where which has actually been the pioneer of EVs, the country which is the largest EV market, where EVs rule the roost. So do you see that as one of the stumbling blocks?
No, as I said, as Power Global, we plan to have 100% sourcing done from India. So we are not looking at any component from outside India. Even for, we are talking to few players for even the cells, that if we can get that from India itself. So we feel that the project would become only sustainable and successful if we have logistically everything available within the country, and we believe that it is possible. So right now our team is working on developing the vendor base in the country, and that is where we are investing right now. So we are just exploring all the options which are there. We have also to see that the existing vendors, what are the capabilities, are there international standards, can they compete to supply products which can be used in other parts of the world, developed world, where the technology and the very stringent norms are being made. So the fit, finish, quality, everything is up to that standard. So we're just developing that right now. But going to your question, we are looking at that targeting. In fact, we are targeting that we get 100% sourcing of the components from India itself.
Okay, fine. So apart from the support from the government, what are the other challenges that you are facing right now? Is it in terms of mass acceptance, or is it because, there are other issues, or is it because of other infrastructure problems, which you have already said? But, anything which you think can be worked upon? The biggest challenge that you're facing, and anything which can be worked upon?
So, creation of an industry is something which is very challenging.
Okay.
And I have handled that before. In my previous assignment, when I launched the product lines, there was no industry for those products, almost negligible or at a very nascent stage. So similarly, is the electric vehicle industry. So I know that when a new industry is developing, there are many challenges, multiple challenges, not just the regular challenges. Sometimes things which are beyond comprehensions also come in front of you. So in terms of challenges, I think everybody knows all of that. Now we have to work on the solution. What is the solution through which the electric vehicle industry can really take off? Okay. If we see, India and China almost started at the same time in the two-wheeler electric space. Maybe a few years here and there, but we were there. We were there very early when we saw a couple of companies, they were betting big and number of players came in. Unfortunately, it couldn't succeed because of various factors, because of the technology, because of the low quality being used. And as a result, the confidence of the people who bought those vehicles became low in this new technology. So that's, I think, the psychological impact of the masses of the customers who use that is the biggest bottleneck, I think, that we need to break. And that can be broken only with a concerted efforts of the industry and government together. It's, again, I say, it's, we have to create a pull strategy. We cannot just push it. So if we push it, nobody will buy. I can guarantee. I've seen this happening multiple times in my experience. Push strategy never works. You say that you do it, I'll do that, this, that, nothing's going to happen. The pull strategy works where you say that, okay, this is the proposal. Customers feel excited. Oh, wow, this is great. Why not? Now, I remember when the technology moved from two-stroke to four-stroke. India was, predominantly a scooter market. Yeah. Everybody used to buy scooters. Nobody used to look at motorcycle. Bolte the motorcycle mat khareedna. Ghutne mein chot lag jati hai. Usme wo khule hote na ghutne. But everybody started buying motorcycles after a few years. Yeah. Why? Because there was a technological breakthrough.
Yeah.
The scooters had you know, lot of safety, front guards, everything, but it was limiting the efficiency of the vehicle also. Whereas motorcycle was more aerodynamics and the technology, the new technologies that were used, so it became like more fuel efficient, almost 50% to 60% more fuel efficient. And the moment you get into that proposal where a new technology is far superior to the old technology, and thus you see that the shift happened from our scooters to the motorcycles.
Yeah. You know?
Similarly, right now also, it happened because there was a pull from the motorcycle. Nobody was pushing, buy a motorcycle, you have to buy a motorcycle. No government was saying, if you don't buy a motorcycle, we'll shut down your scooter factory. Nothing like that. But it happened automatically. Same thing, when you do a pull strategy, things become automatically successful. And this is what we have to look at. How do we create a pull? Now, pull can be created because I give you just an example of an e-retrofit kit. The pull can be created because everybody knows ki, arey yaar, my vehicle will become environment friendly. My life will become easy. My family life will become easy if I convert that into an electric vehicle. And the cost of running my vehicle will come down to 50%, you know.
Okay.
So
okay.
Then people will say, yeah. And you know, there are direct and indirect benefits of the electric vehicle or a zero emission vehicle. The indirect benefits are that the maintenance of the vehicle is very less because there are very few components.
Yes.
So, you know, the major components are removed. So yeah. So you have just a battery, the steering wheel, the brakes, the axle, the tires, simple infrastructure, the basic vehicle, and then the module which is there, you know, the technology coming in. So it's a very latest product range that can be sold to the customer if you amalgamate all these new technologies. So the running cost, the servicing cost of the vehicle, which all of us know that every 3 months to 6 months we have to go to the service station to get the vehicle serviced, and then one or the other component is damaged here and there, so we have to repair that. In electric vehicle, the maintenance cost is very low because they have very little. The component comes down dramatically, almost 70 to 80% components are removed from the vehicle, and yeah, therefore the failure is also removed. They do not fail, and thus the maintenance cost comes down dramatically. So the cost for the people will become more affordable. The only challenge is that how to, you know, get, if I get stuck anywhere that the battery is not there, how will I charge? That's the problem.
Yeah.
And then the second big problem is of the battery. If the battery becomes bad, then I have to pay the full battery again, which is again 60 to 70% of the cost of the vehicle. Then it's like every 3 years or 5 years, I have to buy a new vehicle almost. So those are the challenges that we have to meet through this. We have to overcome these challenges. So there's certain aspect of it that can be done by the industry, and there are certain things that can be done by the government. And to me, I think e-retrofit kit policy by the government would be a big booster for the introduction and expansion of the electric vehicle industry. Because the existing vehicles, which is like 99.99% vehicles, will start getting converted to electric. And the moment that happens, you know, the requirement of the petrol, diesel will come down. The infrastructure and everything will get developed. We will get a cleaner air, healthier air. So all those benefits, indirect benefits, will start coming in.
What is the vision for the company, and also what is your mission for the industry? I mean, if you can, tell us, if you can enlighten our viewers about that.
So vision is, you know, for Power Global, the vision is that we create a public benefit through this company, where, you know, everybody, every stakeholders who get connected directly or indirectly get benefited. And our role in improving the environment is very big. So our vision is that we will be able to clean up the environment through our technologies and we will have a healthier air to breathe on. So those are the clear vision and mission with which this company was formed, and both I and Porter are aligned on this, that we must do this work where we create a better environment. And in order to do that, we also look at that we do the benefit socially to the people of the country as well, by bringing in these technologies, the latest technologies which the world is seeing in India, and scale up the level of the Indian the technology in this space.
But are you not looking at disrupting the automotive industry with your technology?
Oh, no,
disruption is the way forward, because this is what Tesla has done. And Tesla is it has become a poster boy of the auto industry. And I'm sure you also admire companies like Tesla. Why? Because they have been able to disrupt the market, right? So, I mean...
I will make a bold statement to you now. So what Tesla has done in the four-wheeler battery area, Power Global intends to do it the same way in a two-wheelers and three-wheelers battery. So we will be going to bring the technology which is the latest in the two-wheelers and three-wheelers for the batteries.
Thank you, Mr. Dubé. It was a privilege interacting with you. Thank you for sparing your time for BW Business World. And it was a privilege to have you in one of the series of BW Hot Fire.